tonight on NewsWatch, no big hometown celebration for Bo Bergdahl as debate continues around his service to his country and his release from captivity.
Plus, the crisis in Ukraine is center stage at the G7 summit, but one key player is missing.
And thousands imprisoned for their faith globally. Stories like Miriam Ibrahim's capture media attention, but are journalists really covering this growing injustice? All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. No homecoming parade for Sergeant Bo Bergdahl and threats of impeachment for the president. Good evening. I'm Mark Martin.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. As criticism over the release of Sergeant Bo Bergdahl grows, the Obama administration tells lawmakers it didn't notify them in advance because the Taliban had threatened to kill Bergdahl if the deal was made public. Some are also questioning whether Bergdahl and his father sympathized with and even converted to Islam. Heather Sells has our top story.
There will be no hero's welcome in Haley, Idaho for Sergeant Bo Bergdahl. The town has been swamped with hate mail and angry calls labeling him as a traitor. The Taliban captured Bergdahl in 2009 after he walked away from his unit unarmed. The Army is reviewing the circumstances surrounding his capture and says it will make no judgments until it has the facts.
I think a bit unfair to Sergeant Bergdahl's family and to him to presume anything.
But many are raising questions based on the facts so far. In this video released by the Taliban, it is clear that U.S. Special Forces that retrieved Bergdahl took extraordinary precautions. They patted him down to check for explosives, and their straight arms indicate their weapons were concealed. Meanwhile, a Washington Post story reveals that many of Bergdahl's father's friends wondered over the years whether his study of his son's captors led him to sympathize. It reports that Robert Bergdahl maintained he was just trying to ensure his son's release. But CBN News contributor and Middle East expert Raymond Ibrahim believes that both father and son converted to Islam. One telling sign, their beards.
The prophet of Islam, Muhammad, counseled Muslims to grow their beards and clip their mustaches short so they don't look like Christians or Jews. So if they're doing and following these mundane teachings, you can rest assured that other more important teachings, such as hostility for, even if it's just internal, the infidel and the non-Muslim, is also being upheld because that's just logic.
There's also grave concern about the five high-risk Taliban detainees released in exchange for Bergdahl. It's why the administration briefed senators on Capitol Hill late Wednesday.
I believe the decision to release these prisoners put our country in jeopardy.
These are all high-level people. These are people that basically have the ability to go back and hit the ground running. So we're concerned about that.
Bergdahl, meanwhile, continues to recuperate at a U.S. military hospital in Germany. He has yet to make a phone call to his family in Idaho or speak in public. Heather Sells, CBN News.
David French with the American Center for Law and Justice joins us now with more on this story that still has the nation talking. David, Senator Lindsey Graham is threatening to impeach the president if he releases more Guantanamo prisoners without notifying Congress. Do you think that's possible or likely?
I don't know that it's possible, but one thing I do know is if he continues to behave the way he did in the Bergdahl deal, he's going to be continuing to violate the law. In fact, he's violated a law that he signed himself, and that's a very serious matter.
So will there be any kind of punishment for him? I mean, he broke the law.
Well, he's paying a high political price right now. I don't know if you've noticed, but it's getting difficult to find defenders of this deal, even on the Democratic side of the aisle, and key Democratic senators are outraged that they weren't consulted. They don't know why the president chose to break the law.
What do you think about the reaction of the nation? Is this a rush to judgment on Bo Bergdahl?
No, I don't think there's a rush to judgment. So far, there has been no evidence that he behaved honorably on the field of battle when he left his unit. In fact, all of the evidence is unanimous that he left his unit knowingly, voluntarily, which is a serious crime in the Uniform Code of Military Justice. I, like everyone else, am more than eager to hear contrary evidence, more than eager to hear his side of the story. But so far, when you've had a dozen members of his platoon come forward, all with the same story, that tells us a lot. This man appears to have deserted, and we appear to have paid a high ransom to retrieve a deserter.
Many in the military are calling for Bergdahl to be jailed upon arrival in the U.S. What kind of legal action could he face?
Well, he could face a desertion charge, and that is a very serious crime. Leaving your brothers on the field of battle is a very serious crime. One, in fact, that has many times, hundreds of times in American history, been punished by execution. I don't think that's going to happen here. But lest anyone think that what he did was something minor or insignificant, desertion is one of the most serious crimes in the Uniform Code of Military Justice.
All right. David French with the American Center for Law and Justice. Thank you very much for your time, sir.
Thanks so much for having me.
The crisis in Ukraine tops the agenda at the G7 summit in Brussels today without a Russian presence. British Prime Minister David Cameron gave the country a month to meet its conditions or face further sanctions. He called on Russia to recognize Ukraine's new president and support for separatists and stop arms from crossing the border. And as Ephraim Graham reports, America is now sending Ukraine more help.
President Obama says the U.S. is providing Ukraine with $5 million worth of body armor, night vision goggles, and communication equipment as the country's battle against pro-Russia separatists continues. The president announced the aid after meeting with Petro Poroshenko, the country's newly elected president, in Warsaw, Poland, Wednesday.
We will not accept Russia's occupation of Crimea or its violation of Ukraine's sovereignty. Our free nations will stand united so that further Russian provocations will only mean more isolation and cost for Russia.
The fighting in parts of eastern Ukraine is escalating, and that unrest is testing Ukraine's new government. Pro-Russia separatists just took over two government bases near the city of Luhansk, seizing ammunition and explosives. In the face of international condemnation, Russian President Vladimir Putin denies any Russian military involvement in eastern Ukraine.
They are lying. There is no military personnel, not even trainers of the Russian army, in the east or south of Ukraine. And there have never been.
The world's leading industrialized nations are set to meet without Russia for the first time in 17 years. Russia was supposed to host the two-day summit, but was kicked out because of its seizure of Crimea. But France still invited Russia to the 70th anniversary of D-Day events in Normandy this Friday, which sends mixed signals about Europe's stance, and President Obama will likely run into Putin at those events. Despite his attempts to sound strong on Ukraine, many Americans disapprove of President Obama's handling of foreign policy, with some saying he is less capable than former Presidents Bill Clinton or George W. Bush. According to a Fox News poll, 68% say the Obama administration is less competent than Clinton's administration. 48% say it is less competent than Bush's, compared to 42% who say it is more competent. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
French President François Hollande is pushing for a meeting between Russian President Vladimir Putin and Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko around the D-Day ceremonies.
A massacre and the latest attack by Boko Haram on Africa's once most populous Christian nation. The Islamic terrorists, dressed as soldiers, killed more than 200 people. Boko Haram militants arrived in military trucks and told villagers they were there to protect them. Once the villagers gathered together, the terrorists began shouting Allahu Akbar, then started to fire at the crowd. The Nigerian army reportedly failed to come to the aid of the villagers.
The Phoenix Healthcare Facility at the center of a nationwide Veterans Affairs scandal gets a visit today by the new VA chief. Acting VA Secretary Sloan Gibson plans to discuss what has been done to address allegations that numerous veterans have died while waiting to get an appointment. A report by the VA's Inspector General last week found 1,700 Phoenix area veterans were, quote, at risk of being lost or forgotten after not being included on the official waiting list. Gibson took the top spot at the VA after Secretary Eric Shinseki resigned.
A Navy jet crashed into the sea as it attempted a late-night landing on an aircraft carrier. The pilot reportedly ejected and is listed in stable condition. A Navy spokeswoman says the FA-18E Super Hornet was approaching the USS Carl Vinson off the Southern California coast Wednesday night when it went down. And get this, it was the second military aircraft crash in California Wednesday. In the afternoon, a Marine Harrier jet crashed in flames in a residential area. Miraculously, no one was hurt and the pilot safely ejected.
Thank goodness. Well, coming up, a mother in prison for her faith appeals her death sentence and a closer look at the difference media coverage can make for persecuted believers like her.
The American Bible Challenge is back. All new tonight. Jeff Foxworthy is ready to play.
The whole family's gonna love it.
Kirk Franklin's gonna sway.
Are you ready?
And you'll see the Bible in a whole new way.
Don't I look chic?
That was impressive.
The American Bible Challenge. All new tonight, 8, 7 Central. Only on Game Show Network. When it comes to finding true love,
we've got a little surprise for you.
All other dating shows don't have a prayer.
Your church is about to play matchmaker.
Oh, my word.
Natalie Grant and congregations from coast to coast help one of the faithful find their chosen one.
Tall, dark, handsome.
He cries easy.
It Takes a Church premieres tonight at 9, 8 Central, only on Game Show Network. The American Bible Challenge is back. All new tonight. Jeff Foxworthy is ready to play.
The whole family's gonna love it.
Kirk Franklin's gonna sway.
Are you ready?
And you'll see the Bible in a whole new way.
Don't I look chic?
That was impressive.
The American Bible Challenge. All new tonight, 8, 7 Central. Only on Game Show Network. When it comes to finding true love,
we've got a little surprise for you.
All other dating shows don't have a prayer.
Your church is about to play matchmaker.
Oh, my word.
Natalie Grant and congregations from coast to coast help one of the faithful find their chosen one.
Tall, dark, handsome.
He cries easy.
It Takes a Church premieres tonight at 9, 8 Central, only on Game Show Network.
The Christian woman sentenced to death in Sudan for not recanting her faith is appealing the verdict. Miriam Ibrahim's attorney says the appeal demands her release based on procedural errors committed by the court. Sudan's foreign minister says the government can't interfere in the judicial process, but urged Miriam to appeal her sentence.
CBN News contributor and blogger Raymond Ibrahim says stories like Miriam's capture the attention of the mainstream media. He talked about it in his latest blog and with CBN's Ephraim Graham. And he says journalists could do so much more to help see persecuted Christians set free.
CBN contributor and blogger Raymond Ibrahim joins us now to discuss the influence of Western mainstream media on persecuted Christians. Now, you say in your blog that when the Western media, mainstream media gets involved, often Christians are released from unlawful imprisonment. Tell us about that.
Sure. The point I'm trying to make is in the context most recently of Miriam Ibrahim, the Sudanese Christian woman who, of course, is imprisoned in Sudan because she's accused of being born as a Muslim and converting to Christianity. Now she's in prison and she's going awaiting execution. She just had birth in prison. In the context of that story, that story made it into the mainstream media. And you know, sure enough, lots of people were livid at hearing of such a travesty, and lots of people reacted. Human rights organizations condemned it. Politicians such as the UK's Cameron condemned it, and so forth. And so the point I'm trying to make is when that happens, usually good things happen. And in the case of Miriam Ibrahim, it was reported by the BBC that now she's going to be released. Of course, others are saying that that's not true, but that that's Sudan's way of trying to cover up its guilt, really. But either way you look at it, it just shows you that the more media pressure and exposure of the sufferings of Christians in the Islamic world, the better it is.
Do you think it's really possible for the mainstream media to really cover all the persecution for faith that's out there in the world?
No, the point is not, of course, to cover all the persecution. But one of the things that I often see is when it does cover it, there's often this sort of apologetic tone as if, for example, Miriam Ibrahim or Yusuf Nader Khani or Rimsha Masih, they're always portrayed as some sort of aberration. that you don't get the impression when you read this that this is happening habitually and that these people are just the tip of it. So I think the more you can get the truth out, the more, if the media doesn't have to, of course, cover every single incident because it's impossible because there's so much, but if it would provide more context and show you that these things are very common, that are happening all the time, and they're not just these particular incidences, I think that would be very eye-opening to many people in the West.
If you could quantify just a bit, how big of a problem is it?
The persecution of Christians?
Absolutely.
Well, I would say it's the greatest human rights travesty of our time. And again, we go to the mainstream media because someone who's not aware of this, who hears me say that, will probably just, think I'm off my rocker because they've never even heard of it. And that's the point. It's so bad. And yet at the same time, it doesn't fit the politically correct narrative. It doesn't fit the mainstream media general narrative, which is basically that the Islamic world is, tolerant, and that Christians, if anything, they're usually the bad ones who are often the intolerant ones. So that really throws a wrench in the entire mainstream media. But the fact is, from one end of the Islamic world to the other, and as I like to point out, in nations that don't share race or culture or language or socioeconomic conditions, you find the same exact patterns of persecution of Christians and other minorities. And so what is the common denominator? And if you want to be honest, it's Islam.
You're calling out the mainstream media, but how can we as Christians help to change this?
Well, we as Christians could, again, to be honest about the whole thing, spread the word, support those who actually try to bring the word out, support organizations such as CBN, of course, that do shed light on this particular phenomena, and just honesty. And and again, among Christians themselves, I would encourage them to be a little open about this whole thing, because I think among Christians they don't believe this, or they don't accept this, or they don't think that those Christians over there are real Christians. So there's a number of factors that actually work in the mentality of Western Christians that actually hampers their understanding of the situation.
All right, Raymond, as always, thank you so much for your insight.
Thank you.
Raymond's blog, Ibrahim Islam Unveiled, can be found at cbnnews.com.
Up next, he's made a mark for business and jobs in his home state. Can he do it for the nation?
Kids, do you love games? And do you love discovering things?
Yeah!
Well, do you?
Yeah!
Then you're gonna love this. It's the new free Superbook Kids Bible app. You can play games, watch videos, find answers to your questions, and a whole lot more. The new Superbook Kids Bible app. Free downloads available on iTunes and Google Play now.
Stop! Living with hair loss, that is. Losing your hair is no fun, and no one wants to be bald, but there is hope.
Getting my hair back was the best thing that ever happened to me.
I'm happy with the way I look now.
I'm very excited about my hair.
I feel beautiful.
I love my hair.
Hair Club offers all proven hair loss solutions backed by our commitment to satisfaction guarantee. If you're not 100% satisfied with the solution you choose, Hair Club will apply the purchase price to another proven hair loss solution or transplant more hair at no charge.
And it was the best thing I've ever done.
It looks good on me.
Call in the next 5 minutes to get your free brochure at no obligation. It will tell you everything you need to know about your hair loss problem, and it's free if you call now.
I am more pleased than what I had even imagined.
I at least look, I would say, 5 years younger.
I'm 52, and I look better now than I did when I was in my 40s.
I feel great.
And that's not all. The first 100 people who call will also receive $250 off any hair loss solution from Hair Club. Call now.
This is a national healthcare alert from the Health Hotline. If you, a family member, or a loved one suffers from knee pain and have Medicare as your primary insurance, we've got great news. You could qualify for a pain-relieving knee brace at little or no cost to you. Get free delivery, and all the paperwork is handled by our accredited suppliers at no charge to you. If you are on Medicare and have knee pain, don't wait. You may qualify to immediately receive a pain-relieving brace at little or no cost. Friendly agents are standing by 24/7 to help you. Call the Health Hotline right now for details, toll-free. Our friendly representatives are standing by now to take your call. We also have other pain-relieving braces available for shoulder, ankle, and your back. You may be eligible to receive these items and more at little or no cost to you as well. Call right now for details, toll-free.
Operators are standing by. Call 855-740-8143. That's 855-740-8143. Again, 855-740-8143. That's 855-740-8143.
Indiana Governor Mike Pence has been capturing the attention of conservatives. He's fought to make his state business friendly.
He's battled Washington over Medicaid and Obamacare. CBN's David Brody has a closer look at his chances, that is, for a presidential run.
When you meet Mike Pence, he's all American heartland, from a cornfield to Congress and now governor.
I don't ever remember even imagining that this grandson of an Irish immigrant would ever have the chance to lead my state as governor.
And he's making the most of the opportunity, with an approval rating over 60% and one of the top economies in the nation.
Indiana is open for tech business once again. We are grateful for your leadership and your vision.
The numbers show a conservative blueprint for success. 7 straight months of job growth with unemployment under 6%. Leading the nation in new manufacturing jobs, plus throw in tax cuts and a budget surplus for good measure.
There's no rocket science to it. We're just putting into practice those common sense principles of living within our means, letting people keep more of what they earn.
The Republican Party is taking notice. Some GOP bigwigs are courting Pence, and the governor is listening. They see him as an ideal presidential candidate. Pro-life Christian, strong on social issues, a hawk on defense, and economically conservative.
Governor Mike Pence and the First Lady of Indiana headed overseas today on a foreign trade mission.
He's taking his platform to the international stage, and he's going to speak at national GOP functions, stoking presidential interest even further.
All right, now look, every time we speak, I always have to ask you a president. You know I'm going to ask you a presidential. We did this last time. We always do this.
Just a couple years ago, Congressman Pence and I discussed a 2012 presidential run right there in his D.C. office after he won a conservative straw poll.
This is the part of the interview where I ask you the obligatory 2012 question, and this is the obligatory part where you just say, oh, you know, honored to be considered. So let's just go through the formalities here. All right.
So here we are again, 2 years later, trying to figure out a more unique way to pop the question.
Forget about what you think. When Karen and the family hear these, they read the newspaper, they have Google, don't they? What do they think? Forget about you.
Well, I can tell you, any time that I'm mentioned for the highest office in the land is it's a humbling and an encouraging thing for me and for my family. But our focus is on Indiana.
He's also keenly aware that the best solutions need to come from outside the Beltway.
And I'm absolutely convinced that the cure for what ails this country is going to come more from our nation's state capitals than it ever will from our nation's capital. There are just things that states will always be able to do better.
And Pence has his hands full proving that. One challenge is Obamacare.
I think Obamacare needs to be repealed lock, stock, and barrel.
Pence says he won't take available federal money to expand Medicaid here unless it's done the Indiana way.
We're not interested in expanding traditional Medicaid. But if we could, in effect, end traditional Medicaid in Indiana for virtually all of our citizens and replace it with the kind of consumer-driven health care enshrined in the Healthy Indiana Plan, that we would be open to that.
Some conservatives criticize Pence for even considering to take the federal money. The Federalist website says, quote, there is really nothing all that conservative about the state-specific plans to capture federal dollars earmarked for Medicaid expansion. The Healthy Indiana Plan is popular with Hoosiers, though, because it sets up personal health savings accounts. Pence touts it as a national model.
In a word, Indiana has proven in the last 6 years that consumer-driven health care works.
The other big issue, education and Common Core. Pence picked up praise for making Indiana the first state to opt out of the controversial national curriculum, but critics complain that his new standards look a lot like Common Core. Influential conservative Michelle Malkin says Pence's attempts to mollify critics by rebranding and repackaging shoddy Common Core standards is fooling no one.
Whatever differences people might have on the standards that we've produced, there's no doubt these were written by Hoosiers for Hoosiers. And the debate now ultimately is happening here in the state of Indiana where it belongs.
One item not up for debate, his faith.
Just about each and every day, I like to start out my day with a little bit of time in the book, a little bit of time in prayer. And that's become even more important to me as I've shouldered the responsibilities of this office.
Pence gave his life to Jesus as a college freshman, and now as governor, he's mindful of Solomon's prayer in 1 Kings 3, where it says, "Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this your great people?"
It's a prayer I pray often, that for a discerning heart to distinguish between right and wrong. For as he asked, who is able to govern this great people of yours?
And in Indiana, it's Governor Pence for such a time as this. David Brody, CBN News, in Indianapolis, Indiana.
Peace.
Attention, sleep apnea patients. Are you tired of the expense and hassle of getting your CPAP and BiPAP supplies? Are you fed up with dealing with ill-fitting, leaking, or worn-out masks and straps? Are you worried about the effects that unsanitary tubes, cushions, and filters have on your health? If you said yes to any of these questions, Allied Medical Supply Network has the solution to your problems. You could qualify to have your supplies regularly delivered right to your door at little or no cost to you. That's right, no more inconvenience, no worn-out masks and straps, no more unsanitary equipment, just restful sleep. Call Allied Medical Supply Network today to determine if you may qualify to receive your fresh, brand-name supplies at little or no cost. Don't delay. Call us now to see if you are eligible to save money on regular delivery of your CPAP and BiPAP supplies. Call 1-800-815-9947. That's 1-800-815-9947. Or go to CPAPSupplyHelpline.com.
Announcing an important breakthrough in healthcare that can benefit everyone. If you or anyone you love needs affordable health insurance, regardless of a pre-existing medical condition, call Quick Insurance 123 today and get the immediate relief you deserve. Quick Insurance 123 was created to provide affordable health insurance to all uninsured Americans, with or without pre-existing conditions. This is not a discount card. This is a real insurance program that lets you choose from many affordable health plans, with access to doctors, hospitals, emergency services, and more. So call the number on your screen now and get the health coverage you need just for calling. As a special bonus, we'll send you a free prescription savings card that could save you up to 85% on your prescriptions. That's right, you could save up to 85% on your prescriptions just for calling. Call Quick Insurance 123 to find out how you can get affordable health insurance and receive your free prescription savings card just for calling. Don't wait. Getting a free quote is as easy as 123. Call today.
Well, tomorrow marks 70 years since the historical D-Day invasion that led to the end of the Nazi regime.
Ahead of all the big celebrations Friday, 10 surviving veterans of the 29th Infantry Division returned to Normandy's shores to reflect on the day they saw the tide turn for the World War II Allies. The division suffered some of the heaviest losses during the beach attack.
They paid the price. They're the heroes. We have a lot of people with a lot of ribbons, but those guys probably didn't get a single ribbon. But those are the guys I come back for.
Thank you very much.
Wow, God, they deserve our honor, that's for
sure. They sure do. Mm-hmm. That's going to do it for this edition of NewsWatch.
Thanks for watching. Good night.
Good night.